Praise God. What a fun crowd. And so I want to talk about a little more of a serious topic here today for those that are struggling and those that have felt stuck. I feel like these words right here given by the Father actually really didn't come to me till about 3 this morning. And so I feel that God was really wanting these words out. And so we're going to talk about temptations. And it's essential to be tested. It's essential. We have to be tested so that you can even have a relationship with God. What is in your heart? And notice how prepared Christ was. And when he was tempted after his fasting, he just turned it down. But have you ever just been presented with food, and because it's just sitting there, you start nibbling and eating and just eating? Once you've started, you don't stop. What is that? Have you ever felt like something comes over you? This thing comes over you and you just cannot stop. And it feels so strong that you do not know what this force is. It can happen with online shopping. Again, talking too much, the things I keep mentioning. Too little work, too much play, too many computer games, too much wine, too much indulgence in sensual. Was that what you were put on earth for? Well, in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, it says, "There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, a time to uproot. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to tear down, and a time to build. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain. A time to search, and a time to give up. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear, and a time to mend. A time to be silent, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time for war, and a time for peace." There is a time for everything. But note, it does not say that there is a time and a place for sensual indulgence. You know when you are going against your conscience. You also know when your conscience is seared because your spouse or your parents or your boss is trying to get through to you and you didn't feel it from the inside yourself. God himself is not getting through and you're ignoring everything, ignoring your very bad diminishing health, ignoring your diminishing relationships, and you're ignoring your problematic finances. And everything is failing and everything is falling apart, but you choose not to see it. You choose to ignore it. What is this thing that seems to control you? Something comes down and you can't seem to stop, even for God. Well, let's look at the temptations of Jesus Christ and see if we can glean some insights. Matthew chapter 4, it says, "Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, let these stones become bread." Jesus answered, even though, think about how hungry he was. 40 days of fasting. And he answered, "It is written, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you're the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it's written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It's also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Then the devil left him, and the angels came and attended him. And when Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he returned to Galilee. Leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum. And then at the end it says, from that, verse 17, "From that time on, Jesus began to preach, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." Let's break it down. It was bread. Your own body's desires, a temptation. And then he was on the top of the temple. Throw yourself down and watch how God will save you. God will catch you and save you no matter what you do. You're saved. Be a thrill seeker. Throw caution to the wind. Show off to the world and show them how special you are. You're the Son of God. Finally, he's taken to the mountain, shown the kingdoms, all power, all money offered to Christ so that he could fulfill the greed of dominance and control over mankind and have the luxuries of the world. What's going on in this country that we have this much greed, leading the way in greed? And then it's spreading through the world rapidly, as we saw on the map. What is this thing? I've been through, a lot. We say, I just deserve it. These voices again that we talked about earlier. I've had a tough day. I can eat this. I've not eaten much. It doesn't matter, or whatever. I can reward myself with this. The world has fallen prey to Satan. And notice, he was with Jesus in all three temptations, trying to get him to do what? And here's the key. He was trying to get Jesus to be a victim. Make the world center around him. Eat when he wanted to eat, using God to just take this life and just use it, use this life any way he wants to. Thrills for money or indulgence. All the temptations. And notice, that nothing in all of those temptations was about God. Not one of them. But Christ said three times that it was about God. His first one was, man does not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. You don't live on bread alone. You live by every word, every leading. You live by that. But Satan lies continually to drag you into a trap that's far from living on the Word of God. Anything but the Word of God. And has you living from thing to thing and going to place and activity to activity and to, you know, computer game to computer something to busy, 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 busy. So you have to be throwing your heart and your soul and your mind and your strength. If you're going to be like Christ, you're going to have to throw everything in another direction to be ready every single day to make it your priority. How? By telling yourself the truth. There's no other priority. If you wanted to ever be like Christ and get beyond the temptations of your food and lose your weight forever, isn't that what you're going for? You need to be changing up everything, shaking this thing all up, preparing yourself all day long. Now I want to read to you something that's going to help you with your own personal victim feelings. In 1 Corinthians 10, it says, "For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers, that our forefathers were all under the cloud, and they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. Their bodies were scattered over the desert. Now these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. Do not be idolaters as some of them were. It is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in pagan revelry. We should not commit sexual immorality as some of them did. And in one day, 23,000 of them died. We should not test the Lord as some of them did and were killed by snakes. And do not grumble as some of them did. And they were killed by the destroying angel. These things happened to them as examples and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the fulfillment of the ages has come. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, He will also provide a way out, so that you can stand up under it. I know you think that you do prepare yourself by finally deciding that you are not a victim. I'm not a victim. But look, if you're struggling, have you not been demanding the stones to be turned into your chips and dip? You didn't wait on the Lord. Indeed, you've been throwing yourself down from the temple, tempted to do that way too many times, using up your privileges of having God just to save you, tempting God over and over. Save me, God, from this cancer, this heart disease, this diabetes. You're just really testing God. You've lived way too long longing after something out there. Money, power, or indulgence. Power so you can control. Controllers. It may not be the mountain over those, but you're controlling and ruling over people. You always want to be the taker, not the giver. Victims will never make it. There are no victims in heaven. If you reverse it and you realize that God has been the one that's hurt, and his kingdom of God has been muddied by your taking the stones and turning them into bread and not waiting on the Lord. It's all been muddied. People can't find their way home. You could be prepared to respond to all temptations as Christ did. How did Jesus respond? His mind, look how quick it went. It's not about me. It's about God. He's starving hungry 40 days. It's not about me. It's about God. It's not my will. It's God's be done. Man does not live on bread alone, but every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. I mean, it's not about me. It's about God. The world is getting out of control, because Satan's voice has been listened to too much. Look at that map. The world is welcoming the victim voice. I deserve more. I need to eat more. Food comforts me. As it become pagans and they're not turning to God, the map is coming darker and darker and darker, and the white is disappearing, and the redder it's getting, the more severe the immorality. God is testing your heart. And it's time, it's past time, to please God rather than feeling like a victim so that your bodies are scattered and left all over the desert. Because you don't please God over pleasing yourself. Don't you see from this passage in Corinthians, you're not alone? I don't want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers, that our forefathers were all under the cloud. You're not alone. Look at the testing of our forefathers. The forefathers who were under the cloud, and they all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink. They drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them. And that rock was Christ. The rock was Jesus Christ. That's what it says right here. Verse 4. The rock was Christ. What is that spiritual rock of Christ? It's the cup that Christ drank. It was a cup that Jesus Christ asked to be taken away. God didn't take it away. Testing, temptations. It is the signature of our life. If you're not being tested, if you're not being persecuted, I read this morning, then you're not following Christ. It's a part of it. What are we saying here? When you saw how we approach the food table today, trust me, it's so deep. It's so deep. For some, that table is something else. For many people in the world, and it's increasing, it's the actual food on that table. It should not be taken lightly. We're to go all the way to hunger. Hunger. We're to see God all over every eating occasion. We're to consider what has been set before us. Did God give it, or did Satan offer it? Did you turn it in stones into bread, or did you wait for the angels? After he was tempted, the angels went and fed him. We're all to have our eyes open to God and to Christ. And the cup we drink as we're sitting there, it's the cup, the same cup that Christ drank from. Not my will, but yours be done. See how he waited? Even after fasting for 40 days, he waited on God's bites. Even after fasting for 40 days, he didn't go back to self-indulgence, which happens after fasting sometimes with people. He waited on God. Even fasting has to be spirit-led. You ask, what is this thing that comes over? And it's not this thing is coming over just us. Again, it's coming over the world. Not only is time running out, and I don't know what God's going to do with all of it, because the world is becoming more and more greedy. And you look at the map for the momentum, how quickly, from 75 to 2014, 30 quick years, the momentum of victimization is rapidly taking over the world, and the mouth of reason is being hushed by the power of the masses. It's very hard to get through to people right now. You feel like you can't say the truth about sin in the world. We must live every moment like it's our last. You've got this moment right now, everyone here, to let God know how you really feel. And I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you don't let one more test go by, that you do not tell God and show him by the test, look, I'm not a victim. My forefathers went through a lot worse. What Christ went through is a lot worse. There's no one that's not tested. And show him that you love him, and that you love him for being tested, and that it's not about me. It's about you, God. Like Christ, you agree that man must not live on bread alone, but on every word. Looking for his word, looking for his voice, what he's trying to get through to you in the night, what he's trying to get through to you in the day. It's not about you. So many relationships, people try to make it all about themselves, but it's not. It's about the other person. You could always live alone. Relationships, which are so fulfilling, it's about the other. It's about God. God will come back in and take care of you. So reverse the victimization. No temptation is offered that is not common to man. Reverse the victimization, and you will overcome the thing that comes upon you in the evening when you're unsuspecting. Reverse the victimization, and you will stand strong, and you will be able, like Christ in the desert, whether you're hungry and want the bread, whether you're wanting some frivolous thing or to throw yourself in all caution into the wind for relationships or spiritual matters, spending too little time with God, throwing caution to the wind. You'll stop this. I don't have enough money. I don't have enough finance. I don't have enough time. I have it worse than everyone else. You'll stop it. And when you reverse that victimization, you will overcome the thing. See, there's hope for the world that's being covered with this darkness and this blanket of greed. It says in Isaiah chapter 60, verse 2, see, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples, but the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Guys, God didn't send you all this way for you to leave out of here without any hope. God didn't send you here either for you to leave out of here feeling sorry for yourself, or for you to think your situation's more difficult. God brought you here, dear people, because he hand-selected you knowing that you're going to stop that stuff and you're going to end that thing that comes over you. And we're going to put it to death. We're not going to allow it to happen. Satan, be gone, is what I say today. Satan, be gone. God is everything, and we are here to love him with all of our hearts, in all of our souls, in all of our mind, in all of our strength. And if we do this in the victimization, make it all about God, we can be victorious for this glorious, glorious God. Amen.